When you are done with your research and you have a great and promising A/B test idea, you should think about one more thing before starting to implement the actual experiment. That's what's going to be your key metric that you will use to measure and evaluate the success of your A/B test. And that's an important question to answer. Before we go into the details of how to choose the best metric, here are two rules for it. First, your success metric should be defined before the experiment, and you should choose one and only one. Why are these rules so crucial? There are multiple reasons, but here's the most important one: to avoid bias. There is a bias called observer bias, and a specific type of that is called cherry picking. And cherry picking is a risk for you as well. When you put a lot of effort into research and design, and you really think that your new version is better than your original one, well, then you start to fall in love with your new concept and you want it to win. And that's normal, that's a natural human behavior. But if you want to A/B test like a data scientist, you should be very pragmatic. When you have three success metrics, or even worse, when you choose your success metrics after the experiment, you give yourself a chance to lie to yourself. Your brain will automatically start to focus on metrics that will support your new idea that you worked with so much, and it will ignore those metrics that contradict it. When you have three metrics to evaluate your test, you can easily convince yourself to ignore the one that doesn't favor your new variation. But if you have only one success metric, you have no other choice but to listen to that one single number. If it's green, your new version has won. If it's red, your new version has lost. It should be as simple as that. So take my word, you want to choose one metric and you want to commit to it before you start your experiment. I wrote a very detailed article about how to pick the right metrics for your online business. I added a link to it below this video, but here I will talk about how to choose the right metric for your A/B test. A good A/B test success metric should fulfill these three conditions. First, you have enough data points for it. This goes back to statistical significance, of course. It doesn't matter if you have 1 million visitors per month on your website. If you choose a metric for your A/B test that has only, let's say, 3 conversions per month, well, that's not a great metric because you will never have enough data points to get statistically significant results. Just use the sample size calculators that I showed you in the statistics module. With those, you can easily calculate whether the success metric you want to use has a high enough number of data points. The second condition is your success metric can't be a lagging metric. What is a lagging metric? Here is an example. There are several online products that offer a 30-day trial period before asking for payment. It's pretty common. For these products, the trial to paid conversion number, for instance, is a lagging metric. The user starts the trial, but whether she will pay or not, we will only learn that 30 days later. So this is not a good number to look at in your A/B test, because you will have to wait 30 days after starting the test to get your first conversion data point. That's way too slow. So don't choose lagging metrics, try to choose a more immediate metric. And the third condition is, your A/B test success metric should be an important key metric in general for your online business. For example, if you are in a major e-commerce business and you test your landing page, don't choose the click-through rate to XY button as your success metric, choose the number of sales instead. Making people click doesn't impact an e-commerce business. In this case, boosting sales is the real success. Now, in some cases, you can't fulfill all three conditions and you will have to compromise. Let me show you two examples. When I A/B tested the name of this course, I ran Facebook ads. This was only a small initial naming A/B test, so I worked with a smaller budget. I got around 10,000 impressions and 98 click-throughs to my ad. Eventually, 11 people subscribed to the waiting list of the course. My real success metric that would have fulfilled all three conditions would have been the waitlist subscriptions. But I knew that I would have so few subscriptions that I would never have enough data points for this metric to get statistically significant results. So I went with click-throughs instead. I saw that version A, A-B test like a data scientist, got around 2 times more click-throughs than version B, A-B test properly. That's a 99.9% statistical significance rate, so I could conclude this test, and I did, and this was my business decision. I didn't want to spend too much money and time to test the name of the course. Also, I knew that the click-through rate is a good indicator of whether the title of the course grabs people's attention. So I took this minimal risk, and by the way, just in case, I followed up with the subscription metric too. It showed the same spread, although this is not a statistically significant result. The other example is a hypothetical one, and I will use Netflix in it, although I have to mention that I've never worked with Netflix. So again, this is purely hypothetical. So, Netflix offers a free 30-day trial period, and probably for them, it's a really important business metric that how many users paid eventually after the trial period. The problem with it is this. It's a key metric, but it's a lagging metric, so it's not good for A/B testing. Most online businesses overcome this issue by creating an early predictor. An early predictor, as the name suggests, is a conversion metric that you can use to predict your lagging key metric early on. For instance, for Netflix, an early predictor could be the total viewing time of a user in the first 2 days of the trial period. And let's say that Netflix runs the numbers and they find that indeed, if a user watched Netflix for more than 3 hours in the first 2 days of her trial period, then there is an 80% probability that she will stay a paying customer. Boom. They can use that early predictor for their A/B tests, and they won't have to wait 30 days to get the first data points, only 2. Again, this example is purely hypothetical, but I'm pretty sure that Netflix's data science team has already run these predictions, and they have a super accurate and probably even more sophisticated early predictor system. Okay, so summarizing this video, your success metric should be defined before the experiment, and you should choose one and only one of it. And a good success metric should fulfill these 3 conditions. 1, you have enough data points. 2, it's not a lagging metric. And 3, it's an important key metric for your online business.